Belinda presents this unabridged recording of On Violence, written and read by Natasha Stott Despoja. On Violence is dedicated to those women and men who work to keep women and children safe. Proceeds go to Our Watch, the foundation to prevent violence against women and their children. Violence against women and girls is a global pandemic that destroys lives, fractures communities, and holds back development. Former United Nations Secretary General Ban Ki-moon. Everywhere I have been and worked, I've seen the effects of violence against women and children. I have sat with traumatised women in refugee camps on the Syrian border and comforted women in church-run shelters in the jungles of Bougainville. I've listened to women talk about rape as a weapon of war during the Kosovo crisis in 1999, and I've spent time in women's shelters in my home state. I have seen the shame and the stigma, the injuries and after effects, physical and emotional. It is haunting. This violence is a global phenomenon. Worldwide, more than one in three women has been beaten, coerced into sex, or abused in some way. Every 10 minutes, somewhere in the world, an adolescent girl dies as a result of violence. Child marriage affects about 14 million girls every year, robbing them both of their childhood and a future in which they can unlock their full potential. The use of rape as a tactic of war in Iraq, Syria, and elsewhere, the trafficking of women into sexual slavery and domestic servitude, sexual violence against internally displaced women and girls, the kidnapping of schoolgirls in parts of Africa, attacks on girls for simply having the determination to catch a bus to school, the daily horror of domestic and family violence in countries of the Pacific, including South Asia and Australia, these are but a few examples of the patterns of gender-based violence around the globe. In some parts of the Pacific, as many as two in three women have experienced violence. Little wonder the World Health Organization describes violence against women as an epidemic. In Australia, I call it a national emergency. During October 2018, Australia experienced a record death toll of women when 11 women were murdered in 27 days. Police get called to one domestic violence matter every 2 minutes. That's 657 times a day. One in four women in Australia has experienced physical violence since the age of 15, and every week, on average, a woman is killed. Most of these murders take place in the home, and they're often the final brutal act after a long history of violence. Of the women who experience violence, more than half have children in their care. As the former Victorian Chief Commissioner of Police, Ken Lay, said at the National Press Club with me in November 2013, imagine each week an Australian is murdered at a train station. It would be a front-page news story in each of our capital cities. Now I have another figure. Every week, a woman is murdered by her partner or ex-partner. Our public response isn't at all like we imagined it would be if those victims died not in their family rooms, but at train stations. Like many Australians, I'm sickened by the statistics, the body count. We cannot go on like this, with survivors forever maimed physically and mentally, and neighbours and children witnessing appalling acts. It is time to stop this slaughter in our neighbourhoods. I know Australians want change. More women and men than ever before have been approaching me asking what can they do. My advice is always, do something. We all have a role to play. But to achieve an Australia free of violence against women and children, we have to challenge the historically entrenched beliefs and behaviours that drive it, and the social, political and economic structures, practices and systems that support it. We can create a new normal in which men and women, boys and girls, enjoy equal, ethical and respectful relationships. On Violence does not seek to explain the history and causes of violence against women in detail. It is not a specialist text, nor an academic tome. I do not explain the systemic problems in our current policies, nor do I outline exactly what's needed in terms of services or intervention. My focus is prevention. I want to talk about things we can do to stop the violence before it starts. I want to galvanise community and political action. Violence against women is preventable. Because while the issue of gendered violence is a complex one, at its heart, it is also simple. To change the story that ends in violence against women, we must begin with gender equality and respect for all women. The story. Every week in Australia, on average, a woman dies violently, usually at the hands of someone she knows. Six women were killed in a seven-day period in October 2018. However, the alacrity with which our leaders respond to acts of violence in the form of terrorism or, say, one-punch incidents provides a stark contrast to how we deal with family violence or sexual assault, where the victims are almost always female and the perpetrators are almost always male. We often see seemingly trivial issues, such as a slip-up at a Bunnings sausage sizzle, generate more public engagement and policy response than the scourge of violence against women. As unionist Michelle Myers tweeted in November 2018, after the Bunnings mishap, "One man slips on an onion, policies changed, and the country loses its mind. 60 dead women from violence this year. Cue cricket sounds." Writer Clementine Ford tweeted that if the issue of violence was about strawberry growers or farmers, both sectors that have experienced awful crises, our leaders would be acting. This is not facetious. We have seen emergency responses to these issues. When strawberry growers faced a downturn due to a cowardly sabotage attempt, when sewing needles were placed in fruit, a campaign was led by Prime Minister Scott Morrison himself, who lashed out at the grubs responsible and announced new penalties and increased jail time. If people had died as a consequence of this situation, let alone one every 2 days, a national crisis would have been proclaimed. After the horrendous death of a 41-year-old Aboriginal woman in Alice Springs in 2017, a small story in the local newspaper referred to it as being of a domestic nature. Days later, the paper's front page declared it was time to stop the tragedy in the Todd. According to journalist Mickey Perkins, in an article in the Sydney Morning Herald in July 2018, the victim's distraught family and friends mistook this for a campaign to end violence against Aboriginal women. However, the tragedy was a buffelgrass infestation of the Todd River. And the campaign was a call for locals to support a new landcare group. "It was a cruel joke," wrote Perkins. Serious political issues, such as terrorism, rightly garner immediate and robust responses. But the issue of terror in the home, not so. Cartoonist Kathy Wilcox asked readers in one cartoon, "Is it fair to compare radical violent terror attacks to domestic violence in terms of threats to our way of life? Of course not. Every time a terrorist attacks, or nearly attacks, we have to change laws, tighten security, blame certain communities, debate immigration, and demonise our fellow citizens. Whereas every time another person assaults or kills their partner, nothing changes. We're sad, but we carry on, because that is our way of life." Australians are ready for a change to this way of life. There is growing concern about the treatment of women. Me Too, Let Her Speak, Time's Up, and other movements that challenge long-held practices and discrimination are sweeping the globe. And in Australia, a spotlight is being shone on issues relating to sexism and sexual harassment. In June 2018, the Australian Sex Discrimination Commissioner, Kate Jenkins, established the largest ever inquiry into sexual harassment. While in March of the same year, journalist Tracy Spicer launched Now Australia, an organisation to help survivors of sexual harassment and assault in workplaces, notably in the media industry. In spite of inquiries, including a Senate inquiry into violence against women with disabilities and the landmark Victorian Royal Commission into Family Violence, the pace and rate of change are too slow and government attention waxes and wanes. We have seen how momentum can be lost on this issue. In 2015, there was a wave of optimism. This would be the year that changed lives and laws. Behaviours and attitudes would alter, and our nation's leaders of all persuasions would designate the issue of gendered violence in Australia an emergency. This hope was due in no small part to Rosie Batty. She was seared into our consciousness when her son Luke was murdered by his father at a local cricket game in February 2014. A woman who endured unimaginable tragedy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.